Hi guys, thanks for coming back to the Exilva blog. It's been a nice summer. We're back here with the Topic Tuesday. Today's subject is making emulsions, how to test with new alternatives when making emulsions, and how to judge this. I'm joined here today by one of my colleagues from the Cellulose Fibrils area in Beauregard. It's our senior scientist, Rebecca Blell. Welcome.
Thank you.
And hello. Thanks for joining the Exilva blog and Topic Tuesday.
Thanks for asking me.
Good. So we're going to discuss the topic of making emulsions today. But first, Rebecca, could you tell us a little bit about what is an emulsion?
I would say it in very simple terms. An emulsion is a liquid dispersion in another liquid. So when you have two immiscible liquids, for example, oil and water, very simple, they usually won't mix. So you can make an emulsion and have them mix together. The oil, the water, and something that will bring them together is an emulsifier.
Mm-hmm. So what do you typically encounter of various problems relating? If you're making an oil and water emulsion, I try to do that at home, mixing oil and water. What can you explain a little bit short about what typical issues could be?
A very typical is that you have the oil water that looks good when you just mix it, and as soon as you stop mixing, you see the oil separates from the water.
Right.
This can happen immediately or it can happen over some time.
And that's the most typical issue, I guess.
Most typical.
So the components of an emulsion, how, if you would say the three most important components of making a good emulsion, what would that be?
I think it's the ratio of your two liquids that you want to emulsify together, and to choose the right ingredient to emulsify them. So bring them together,
yeah.
And then of course a stabilizer to make them stable over a long time.
Okay.
So then you have the emulsion stable immediately, and a stabilizer to keep it stable for a longer time.
Ah, so key. So stabilization. Okay. So that brings me over to the next subject, because I'm curious about these typical additives for doing this, and for stabilizing, as you say. What choices do we have? What opportunities are currently there, and what's new on this market for, like, I would say, additives for stabilizing these emulsions?
Most people use thickeners for stabilizers.
Okay.
So you have the synthetic thickeners like acrylates, but
yeah.
You also have hydrocolloids, and biopolymers are used for that.
Any differences between these solubles, insoluble, stuff like that?
The insoluble polymers, they are probably very sensitive to the chemistry, to the environment, to what surfactant you're using. And the physical, you have also these insoluble polymers or insoluble materials like clays and fibrils,
yeah.
That will physically do the work instead of chemically forming
okay.
a structure.
Yeah. Okay, so we're talking about the stabilization and trying to solve problems with the stabilization, but trying to think along or down the line, in the application-wise, do we see differences in these type of additives? Like, for instance, santan and the cellulose fibrils, that's a fairly new technology.
Yep.
Would you see that we see differences in how it's applied as well?
You mean the way they are used? In
yeah,
the
yeah, yeah. And how, during share, for instance, yeah. how do they react?
So xanthan gum and cellulose fibrils are natural polymers.
Yeah.
They are both shear thinning and have high viscosity at rest, which make them good stabilizers.
Yeah.
But the differences could be in how high viscosity at rest they have, and the way they are shear thinning. But how do they? How does that work? For example, let's say in a simple way, if you are spraying them.
Yes.
The xanthan gum, you can spray it or you can get it out of the spray bottle.
Yeah.
But it won't come out as a spray, while the cellulose fibrils, we have seen in earlier blog posts that you can get it out as a nice spray. That
yeah.
could be a difference in the application.
Okay, cool. So when you're making an emulsion and you try to solve problems, what areas do you typically have also when you do the emulsion? I mean, are there any items, any subjects that you need to be aware of?
You have to be, I think it's the processing of the way you prepare the emulsion, like really how you're mixing the ingredients together, the choice of ingredients, the concentrations of all.
Yeah.
For example, both xanthan gum and cellulose fibrils, you should incorporate them in the recommended way.
Yeah.
Cellulose fibrils, you have to put them in the water phase, in the or the most polar phase of your formulation. While xanthan gum, you have to prehydrate it before use so that you have it working efficiently in your emulsion.
Okay.
Actually, the mixing also is important. The high shear mixing will allow you to incorporate xanthan gum and cellulose fibrils correctly and also determine the size of the oil droplets, for example, in your emulsion.
Right.
And this also affects the stability over time.
Okay, so we were talking about this. Let's stick with the xanthan and cellulose fibrils because they are natural polymers both. Where would you like to mix those in? I mean, where would it be natural? In what phase? And do they differ in that sense?
They slightly differ, yes. If you go to xanthan producers or cellulose fibril producers, you will see that they both give recommendations on how to incorporate it.
Yeah.
One common thing is that you need to use high shear mixing for both.
Yeah.
For the cellulose fibrils, you have to add them in the water phase, the most polar phase of the formulation, because you will not manage to have them dispersed in the oil phase.
Yeah.
They are hydrophilic. They are have a lot of OH groups.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful on doing that correctly. And both are possible to disperse in water at low and high temperature.
Okay. If you have a high pH system, low pH system, and a wide range, for instance, in pHs, in the different types of systems, so you want one complementary additive, which one would you recommend in these areas?
Knowing that more experience with cellulose fibrils, I know
okay.
that cellulose fibrils are stable at very wide pH range.
Okay.
They are a physical network of fibrils, very little affected by the chemistry.
Yeah.
So as long as it's hydrophilic or polar environment, they are and you are able to disperse them correctly to get the network,
yeah.
they are stable at very low pH, 1 to 13.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. But with more hydrophobic systems, would xanthan be the better fit, or would you go in other directions?
No, xanthan gum is not going to solubilize in a hydrophobic environment. It would be just a way to disperse it correctly before
yeah.
getting it into the
okay.
into the water phase.
Yeah. Interesting. I didn't know that. So thinking about introducing these new technologies, would you have any major items you need to think about when you do this?
Of course, the way you are using them.
Yeah.
The concentration at which you are using them, because it depends, of course, on what is your target. Do you want them to stabilize? Do you want them to give extra performance? Cellulose fibrils, for example, have additional performance in other performance in formulation. They are multifunctional.
Yeah.
So you might want the end functionality rather than the stabilization. So you have to adapt the concentration to that. But also you might think about the sustainability, and you need to use renewable sources in
yeah.
your emulsion. You are get your emulsion more green. That's something.
Thank you very much, Rebecca. Thank you for being here. Thank you for contributing to the Topic Tuesdays. I hope you guys saw this as an interesting post, and I welcome you back next time with another one of our experts and a new topic.
Thank you.